This is Coding Math, Episode 16, Springs, Part 2. Last week, I covered the basics of how springs work, and hopefully you now share a little bit of my enthusiasm for the subject. Today, we're going to ramp it up a notch. Now, to recap the first episode on springs, we had a spring point that a weight was attached to. The further away the weight was from that point, the more the attracting force was. And we had a value called k, which was the spring constant, and that controlled the stiffness of the spring, which dictates how strong that pulling force will be. Now, in those examples, the weight would always settle exactly on that spring point. You may remember in the beginning of the episode, I said that the spring had a length of zero. But in some instances, you may want to simulate the spring itself as a physical object that has size. We'll call that length. The spring would be fixed at this point and free on this side here, where the weight was attached. The length of this spring represents the size of the spring when it's at rest. Nothing's pulling or pushing on it at all. Let's say it's 100 pixels, going with the idea that we'll eventually be drawing this on a canvas. So now, instead of coming to rest on this fixed point of the spring, the weight will eventually come to rest over here, 100 pixels away from this fixed point. So in this simple case, where we're just moving along one axis, all we're really doing is saying that the spring point is over here instead of over here. But where this gets interesting is when we move to two dimensions, and we let the spring rotate around this fixed point. Now say the weight is already moving with a velocity something like this. The spring pulls on it with a force vector something like this, and its new velocity winds up like this, so that the weight ends up here on the next iteration. And this causes the spring to rotate around so that it continues to face the weight. Then, when we calculate the ideal resting point for the spring again, it's now over here. This is the point where the spring is now going to try to spring to. So it's a moving target. But it's always going to be somewhere in a 100 pixel radius circle around this fixed point. So how do we code this? Well, working with vectors, it winds up being quite easy. What we've been doing so far is calculating a distance vector that goes from the weight's position to the spring point. We do this by subtracting the weight position vector from the spring point vector. Then we're multiplying that vector by the spring constant k to get a force vector that we then add to the weight's velocity. Now, what we want to do is spring not to the spring point, but to a point 100 pixels away from it. We just got this distance vector that goes between the two points. If we get that vector's length, then subtract 100 from it, it gives us the distance vector that points from the weight's position to this point here, which is the actual position we want to spring to. Now, just as before, we can multiply by k to get the spring force and add that to the velocity. Now let's see what this actually looks like in code. Going back to the code we ended up with last week, I'm first just going to add a spring length variable. We'll set this to 100, just like we've been demoing. I'm going to comment out the mouse move code here for now, just to keep things simple. Now down here in the update function, I'm getting the distance vector by subtracting weight position from spring point. Next, I want to get that vector's length and subtract the spring's length from it. So I can say distance set length distance get length minus spring length. Again, I'm getting the current length of the vector, subtracting spring length, and then setting the length of the vector to that value. And it's as simple as that. We have a distance vector that's a bit shorter than it was, and we multiply that by k and add that to velocity. So let's see what that looks like. Cool, so it's doing what we expect. We don't know where it's going to settle down, but it's always going to be somewhere 100 pixels away from that spring point. Now we can uncomment that mouse move code and see what this looks like. All Okay, so now we're springing to a point offset from a moving target. Things are starting to get cool here. Let's add some gravity into the mix. We'll give the weight a gravity of 0.5. Now we have a weight hanging from a string, or a rubber stick, or something. Well, it's cool, but it's just going to get cooler. Now, years ago, when I was first experimenting with all this stuff, I said to myself, "Self," I said, "you can spring to a fixed point, and you can spring to a moving point, and I can spring to an offset from a moving point, but can I have two objects spring to each other?" My gut feeling was that this was going to set up some kind of feedback loop, and it was just going to go out of control and either get chaotic or crash the program. So naturally, I tried it. To my shock, it didn't do any of those things, and it opened up doors to all kinds of cool effects and increased my love of springs 100-fold. So here's the idea. We have an object here. We'll use a particle. And we have another one over here. Well, both of those particles have positions, which are vectors. And we can define an offset from each position, just like the spring length variable we used in the last example. So we have this particle spring to the offset of that particle's position. And we have that one spring to the offset from this one's position. Without the offset, the particles would just spring directly to each other and settle on a single point, which would be kind of boring. The offset keeps them separated. I'm going to start a new file here called spring2.js. It's the standard animation template that I start all the animated examples with. I'm going to add a particle, particle A, and give it a random position and velocity. I'll even use the random range functions we created a few minis back. Then I'll duplicate that, making particle B. Now we'll also need a k value, which I'll set to a nice low 0.01. And I'll create a variable called separation. This will be the offset, or the spring length. Then I'll give each particle a friction of 0.9 and a radius of 20. Now the low spring constant and high friction are going to help to give the final piece some stability. Now in the update function, I'll first clear the canvas, then update both particles. I'll draw a circle for each one of them using the particles x, y, and radius properties. And then I'll draw a line between them. Now, we should be able to run this now and see what happens without any springing going on. Cool, so the particles just move off in different directions and a line gets drawn between them. About what we'd expect. Now, back in the code, I'll add a spring function. This will take two particles and a separation as parameters. Now, what we do in here is essentially the same thing as we did in the last example, but we're going to use one particle, P0, as the spring point, and the other one, P1, as the weight. We get a distance vector between the two, and we subtract the separation value from that vector's length, and we multiply that by k to get a force vector, and add that to P1's velocity. Now, I could do this all over again, swapping the particles' roles so that P0 is the weight and P1 is the spring point. But if I did that, the force that I'd wind up with would be exactly opposite to the force I just calculated. So rather than going through all those extra calculations, I'll just subtract that force from P0's velocity. This gives the exact same result as adding a reversed vector to that velocity. Now, in update, we just need to call spring, particle A, particle B, separation. And that's all we need to do. Hold on to your hat as we test this one. And look at that, no feedback loop, no chaos, no crash. The two particles just spring to within a certain distance of each other and reach an equilibrium there. It's sort of an ad hoc, springy, rigid body physics kind of thing. Okay, we're on a roll here, so let's add another particle. Particle C. We'll just copy and paste this, change the name. We'll give it the same friction and our radius. And then in update, we'll connect all three of these particles. So we'll spring particles A and B, then B and C, then C and A. We'll have to update C as well. And draw a circle for C. And then draw a line from B to C and from C to A. Okay, ready to test this? Now, I think you'll agree that this is indeed wicked pissa, even if you don't know what that means. Now, for one final demo, I've added some gravity and some edge handling. And if you didn't get it before, I hope you now know why I love spring so much. See if you can code up this final example for yourself. If you run into trouble, I've included the file in the repo as spring3.js. I think it's a pretty cool effect for so little code. There's so much here for you to experiment with. You can try changing the K values, change the friction, use different gravities for different particles, create different forms with different numbers of particles, different offsets between the particles. Some particles can be connected, others are not connected. All kinds of things you can do. So that's all for this week. I hope you enjoy this as much as I do, and I'd love to see where you take this and what kind of applications you use it for.